This week on Wealth Track, two retirement pros, State Street Global Advisors Fredrik Axsater and Kennedy School of Government's Brigitte Madrian, have workable solutions to solve the retirement savings crisis. What they are and what individuals can do for themselves are next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management,
Active Management, Flexible Perspective,
Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. There is a retirement crisis in this country that is escalating as an estimated 10,000 baby boomers a day turn 65. Two-thirds, or 40 million of the approximately 76 million boomers, are already 65 or older. And Social Security, which nearly two-thirds of boomers cite as their major source of retirement income, is headed for insolvency. Unless changes are made to Social Security in terms of increased funding and tighter eligibility, the program is projected to spend more than it earns by the end of this decade and will be completely depleted by 2034. But it's not just baby boomers who are in trouble. With the demise of traditional pension plans and increased longevity, younger Americans are facing enormous savings and retirement plan shortfalls as well, unless their savings and investing habits change. It is past time to address the crisis. 2016 is the 10th anniversary of the Pension Protection Act, or PPA, which was largely designed to shore up financially troubled defined benefit plans and their insurer. But the legislation also vastly improved the health of defined contribution plans, including 401ks, now the dominant individual retirement savings vehicle for those Americans who are offered such plans at work, mostly at large companies. However, there is a huge gap in access for employees of small businesses, long the primary drivers of job creation and employment. Nearly 40% of working households do not have access to employer-based plans, and the vast majority of part-time and contract workers are left out entirely. Well, momentum is building from the private and public sector to change this and offer much greater access to retirement plans that work for employers and employees alike. And this week's guests are in the forefront of these efforts. Brigitte Madrian is Harvard Professor of Public Policy at the Kennedy School of Government. Since 2014, she has also been one of the 19 members of the Commission on Retirement Security and Personal Savings set up by the Bipartisan Policy Center. The Commission of Business, Political, and Policy Leaders recently issued its recommendations to reform Social Security, broaden access to workplace retirement plans, and promote savings. Fredrik Axsater is the global head of defined contribution at State Street Global Advisors, which oversees more than $2 trillion in both actively managed and passive assets globally. About $300 billion of that is in global defined contribution plans. SSGA is the investment management arm of State Street Corporation. Axsater, who joined SSGA in 2011, has devoted his professional career to making retirement work for employers and employees around the world. SSGA's CEO Ron O'Hanley recently wrote an open letter to Congress calling for mandated workplace retirement coverage for all private sector workers. I began the interview by asking both guests why they are focusing on the workplace as key to solving the retirement crisis.
The answer to that question is really easy. It's that payroll deduction is the most effective mechanism to help people save for retirement, and payroll deduction happens at the workplace. There's a reason why decades ago the federal government decided to start collecting income taxes through payroll deduction, because that's the way you get people to pay your taxes. It's also the way you get people to save for retirement.
So from a public policy point of view, it was a clear decision. From your point of view, Fredrik, from SSGA, and you know, you're dealing with clients, both governments and corporate clients all over the world. They could be doing, you know, national mandates, for instance, governments could. Why have you focused on the workplace as well?
Yeah, it's 40% of Americans, to Bridget's point, do not have access to a workplace pension.
So it's, right.
it's the most straightforward, simple way of really increasing access for all working Americans. And this is particularly important for small businesses. So you can imagine a typical day for you, go to the dry cleaner, go to your favorite restaurant. Chances are that more than half of the people that you interact with do not have access to a workplace pension plan.
Right.
It is so important to create that in order to really close that retirement challenge today for Americans.
And why don't individual retirement accounts do the job?
They don't do the job because you have to take action and be proactive. And most Americans are not financial experts. And it's really hard to make the complicated decisions about which investment company should I go to open up an IRA, how much should I contribute, what asset allocation should I choose. Those are really hard questions if you are not an economist or
right.
or a MBA in finance, if you're just a nurse, a teacher, an engineer, a plumber, an architect, those aren't necessarily things that you were trained in doing. So a big advantage of a workplace plan is that someone else can make all of those difficult choices, and then all you have to do is decide, do I like those options that someone else picked, or am I not in a position to save today? And we've seen dramatic differences in savings outcomes when employers pick a good default and just put employees in the savings plan.
Frederick, how would it work as far as what SSGA is proposing? How would it work to extend access, especially to these small businesses that you're talking about?
First of all, it needs to be a national framework for all employers in the U.S. to offer auto-enrollment, to make success easy, to make failure more difficult, and saving for retirement.
And why does it have to be national? There are many states that are enacting plans like this. Why is it so important that it's a national effort?
Because then it really becomes comprehensive. I mean, I think what the states are doing is terrific, but it's also a little bit of a patchwork of different plans that are being set up state by state.
Right.
Let's have one national framework.
How are you proposing to streamline this process for employers, Bridget, so that it's not as expensive for them, and also that there aren't the liabilities associated and the choices? I mean, most small business owners, they're not financial experts either.
Exactly. So one proposal would be to make it very easy for someone else to come in and set up a plan for small employers. In the jargon today, these are called multiple employer plans.
Right.
In the Bipartisan Policy Center Commission report that I worked on, we call them retirement security plans. But it would be a mechanism for a third party to set up a plan that would serve lots of small businesses. It would relieve the small business owner of the fiduciary responsibility, all of the legal liability they might go along with offering a plan, and it would relieve the employer of the responsibility of picking who should run the plan and what the assets should be and all the management issues. Someone else is doing that. So first set up these plans that make it easy and low cost for a small business to offer a plan, and then go in and require that small businesses offer a plan. The UK rolled out a reform like this in 2012, and they've rolled it out over a multi-year period. It's not done yet. They started with the biggest employers. They're going down by firm size. And in 3 years, they've seen the fraction of their workforce participating in a workplace savings plan go up by 20 percentage points, which is an enormous change. And there's no reason we couldn't see that kind of success in the U.S. as well.
Right. Go ahead, Fredrik.
And then in terms of, on that example, in the UK, these multiple employer plans, there the name is Master Trusts. And one of our clients there, People's Pension, have 2 million participants. So it really shows the kind of teaming up of many different small businesses. They say it takes them 4 minutes only to sign up a new business. That's how simple it may get for business, for small businesses to use these type of programs.
And who are these third parties? Are they firms such as State Street Global Advisors, for instance? So they have to be investment firms that are going to be the third party providers.
It can be a firm like State Street Global Advisors. It can also be nonprofit organizations. And that's really what you're seeing in the UK. And I think that establishing a national framework leads to great competition across different types of entities that can act as these multiple employer plans.
Yeah, and a really natural other entity to offer such a plan might be a payroll processor. Processor is already processing the payroll. They're in a great position to just add another line item deduction to go into a retirement plan. And then another very natural entity would be the state governments. We've got a lot of states who are interested in these issues. They're already moving into that space because we've had a void at the national level. So there are lots of different ways that you could make this system work. There's a lot of flexibility that might not be immediately apparent.
And we're talking about the employer's role and how to make their participation easier. The employees are also key to this. You two have applied behavioral finance principles to these decisions that you're doing as well. So Fredrik, you two had mentioned auto-enrollment, for instance, and the reason is because if we're given a choice as an employer, frequently we just don't bother to sign up. So automatic enrollment is important. Do we have a chance to opt out if we want to make the decision not to participate?
Certainly. I think that opting out is important. But employees want that help from the employer. They want that guidance. They appreciate it. Even the people that opt out, two-thirds of them are saying that it's good that you have this auto-enrollment in place.
Right.
The experience in the UK is that only 10% of employees opt out.
And what about the appropriate savings level? I mean, we talk a lot now in this country about the underfunding in retirement and the fact that, you know, that individuals aren't saving enough, they're not investing enough. And Brigitte, it's something you call leakage, that in fact that we frequently will take our money out of our 401k, sometimes even if there's a penalty for, you know, emergencies, that we don't keep the money invested long term. How are you addressing that leakage problem?
So on the getting people to save enough, I think there are two separate problems. One is getting people to save enough, and then one people is keeping the money in the system. So to get people to save enough, easy way to do that is just set the default contribution rate under automatic enrollment at a high enough level to generate adequate income in retirement when coupled with Social Security.
And what's a high enough level?
Well, I mean, that depends on a lot of factors, but I think a lot of people would say you want to get most people up to, say, a 10% contribution rate, and that coupled with the employer match, coupled with Social Security, will probably do do right by most people. There's going to be some heterogeneity, but I think that would be a useful benchmark to think about. And then your second question, how do we keep money in the system? So right now, for every dollar that goes into the retirement system, 40 cents is coming out before retirement, before people reach the age of 55. Mm. So it's money that's being saved, but it's not being saved for retirement. So there are a number of things we could do. We could reduce the allowable circumstances in which you can take the money out before retirement. We could encourage companies to put restrictions on the employer match. So maybe you can use your money before retirement, but you can't use the employer matching contributions before retirement. We know a lot of the money that comes out happens when individuals change jobs. And it turns out we have a system where it's very easy to get your money out from
of your 401k.
Yeah, mm-hmm. out from your previous employer, and it's really difficult to transfer that money to a new employer's plan. Lots of paperwork, lots of hassle involved. So one suggestion that I think industry is largely behind would be to create a retirement clearinghouse where it would be very easy to just go in there and say, move my money from this plan to this plan, and makes it easy to keep the money in instead of taking it out.
You two have been working in this separately for 20 years. Now you're working together as well. But, you know, why now? What's happened? What's changed?
There are three things that have changed. First is longevity has changed. People live longer. Chances are for the people that have born over the last few years that many of them will live past 100. Second is that they're just lower expected returns and yields in the market. We did a study where we showed just using expected returns and so forth 10 years ago around the financial crisis, if we save 11% throughout our career, we would have about a 69% income replacement. And that's consistent with what many of us are looking for.
Right.
Fast forward to today, the same 11% savings rate throughout our career only leads to a 46% income replacement.
Because of the low returns that you're getting in the markets.
That's exactly right. Our income is cut by a third.
And the one thing that we haven't talked about, and Brigitte, you mentioned, was Social Security. So very briefly, I know the commission addressed Social Security. You think it needs to be restructured quickly. What are your proposals?
Yeah, so I think an important point to note is that it's really hard to figure out how much you need to be saving on your own for retirement if you don't know what you're going to get out of Social Security. And the fiscal uncertainties around Social Security, is it going to be there? How much will it be cut
right.
in 2034 when the trust fund runs out? Make it really hard for anyone today to figure out how much they need to be saving. So we need to restore long-term fiscal sustainability to Social Security. And the way to do that is through a small increase in payroll taxes, mm-hmm. A increase in the earnings threshold for which earnings are taxed for Social Security purposes, and a increase in the normal retirement age, and we propose to increase it to 69 over the next 48 years.
So over the next 48 years.
By 1 month every 2 years, and our projection is that that's roughly going to keep pace with projected increases in longevity, leave people with the same amount of time in retirement.
Known as the third rail,
yes.
which is any sort of mention of reform of Social Security, what are the likelihoods, number one, of the kinds of plans that the commission and that SSGA is recommending for increasing access to workplace retirement plans? What is the likelihood of that happening?
I say the chances are good. We're seeing a lot of traction right now on both sides of the aisle. And that's really how we designed this plan. We designed it to be comprehensive, to have about a $750 billion impact on the retirement shortfall. We designed it to be simple, and we also designed it to have to be able to get bipartisan support. And so we're seeing the response that we're getting from policymakers are mostly yes and.
Yes and?
Yes and. Yes, we like everything that you're proposing, and we would like these other things as well, which I think is terrific. And at the same time, we need to have a comprehensive, simple program that can be acted on over the next 12 months.
And from the commission's point of view, what do you think? And I know that there are similarities between SSGA and what the commission's doing, but the kind of proposals that you're making, what is the likelihood?
And I think on the access side, I think they're good. And I think one of the really favorable indications on that front is that we have been seeing so much action at the state level in both Republican states and in Democratic states. So that there's a problem is not a partisan issue, and that we can come up with solutions is also not a partisan issue. So I think we can get traction on the access side. With respect to Social Security, I think we need to have an open and honest discourse, and we have to take the partisanship out of it. So raising taxes and cutting benefits, those are the only ways to ensure the fiscal sustainability of the Social Security system. So the argument just can't be, oh, you supported raising taxes and cutting benefits, you're a bad guy. No, that's the way you actually preserve benefits.
And that was the most contentious discussion with your commission as well, right?
Yes,
it was over
absolutely.
Social Security. At the end of every WEALTHTRACK, we ask our guests what is the one investment we should all make in a long-term diversified portfolio. In this case, it would be for retirement. And Fredrik, yours is?
Mine is easy. It's a target date fund. It's a simple and sophisticated solution that automatically rebalances, becomes more conservative over time. And also allows you to spend time on these other factors that are so important for you financially, like being able to start saving earlier, saving more, and for that matter, as Brigitte mentioned, also these decisions on when to take Social Security.
And the target date fund, you have in your background, you actually managed one of the early target date funds many, many years ago. Why is that kind of the perfect go-to vehicle for retirement saving?
When talking to individuals, we see that about 70% say that they don't have the knowledge, interest, and the time to spend on their retirement savings. A target date fund does a very good job for them. It automatically rebalances, becomes more conservative over time.
And Brigitte, what is yours?
And mine is that the target date fund doesn't matter if you're not saving. So my advice would be stop procrastinating and start saving for retirement if you're not already doing it. Sign up for your employer's plan if you haven't been automatically enrolled or if you opted out, or sign up for an IRA if your employer doesn't already have one. Don't let the better be the enemy of the good. Don't wait around for the 401k fairy to come tell you what to do. Start doing it today.
There's one more thing I want to ask each of you as well, is that I know you mentioned the target date fund, Fredrik, and I know that SSGA is also recommending annuities. Social Security is like an annuity. You've got guaranteed income for life, but you also feel that that should be part of many retirement plans as well. It should be an option. Why is that?
And
we're talking about immediate annuities or deferred income annuities, right?
Yeah, so this starts with the consumer, starts with the worker, saying that, how do we plan for retirement? The planning early in retirement is relatively straightforward, but then planning for late retirement is very challenging. We don't really know what it will be like, and hope becomes our main retirement strategy. I hope things will work out. I hope my daughter will take care of me. We need something to provide a backstop, some insurance to make sure that we have the retirement that we want and that we deserve. And deferred annuities in particular has that ability to provide that as when it's part of a target date fund, to provide a higher and more predictable income stream, to move away from hope as a main investment strategy, to really move towards predictability and empowerment.
Brigitte, what's your view on annuities?
Well, we know that life expectancy, which for men and women is mid-80s,
right?
It's an average, but there's huge variability around that average. And it's really hard if you're planning your retirement to meet life expectancy at, say, 85, and then you live to be 100. You've got 15 years that you weren't planning on. So, unfortunately, life expectancy does not mean this is when you're going to die. It means on average, this is when people die, but a lot of people
live
quite a bit longer.
Yes.
And an annuity is a very sensible insurance product. Just like you insure your home against a fire, you insure your car against an accident, you insure your spouse and your kids against your own death with life insurance when you're alive. An annuity is the way that you insure your financial future against living to be a very old age. And living a long time is a good thing, but it's a better thing if you've got the financial resources to sustain that. And you do that with an annuity.
So terrific. And thank you so much, both of you, for devoting so much of your professional lives to solving this retirement problem. It's just key to our financial futures. So Brigitte Madrian from Harvard, thank you so much for being here. And Fredrik Axsater, it's just great to see you from SSGA. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is have a savings account separate from your retirement account. Brigitte Madrian just told us that 40 cents of every dollar that goes into the retirement system is taken out before people reach 55. Having a separate savings account for emergencies and non-retirement related expenditures will prevent that from happening. Tune in next week. We will have an exclusive and extremely rare interview with the Fairholme Fund's Bruce Berkowitz. Why is this deep value investor fighting the federal government over Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac? We'll find out. If you go to our website's extra feature, you will also discover why this week's guests have devoted their professional lives to help us save and have secure retirements. We are benefiting from their efforts. Also, please feel free to reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management, Flexible Perspective, Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.